I see a few wary faces, a few hungry faces. So it's proud, I'm feeling very proud to announce that we move to our final panel discussion for the day, ladies and gentlemen. We'll be discussing the motion of status of media education in India. The panel chair for this session, please welcome Mr. Suman K. Jha, Executive Editor, BW Business World. Joining him on stage to debate the motion, please welcome Professor Stephen Quinn, Principal Mojo Media Insights, Professor Devesh Kishore, Professor Emeritus, Makhan Lal Chaturvedi, National University of Journalism and Mass Communication, Noida Campus, Professor Biswajit Das, Director, Center for Culture, Media and Governance, Jamia Millia Islamia, New Delhi, Professor C.K. Sardana, Member, Academic Council, Kushabhau Thakre University of Journalism and Mass Communication, Raipur, Professor Ujwal Chaudhary, Dean, School of Media, Pearl Academy, Delhi and Mumbai, Mr. Sajal Mukherjee, Director, APJ Institute of Mass Communication, Dwarka, New Delhi, Professor Hemant Joshi, Course Director, HJ IIMC, that will be Hindi Journalism, Professor Sunil Kant Behra, Head, Tejpur University. I request all my panelists to please join the chair on stage.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. So, in a way, we have been discussing this since this morning, the status of media education in India. We have a very distinguished panel here. Now, in a different context, we say that we get the democracy we deserve. Similarly, we get the media we deserve. But then, do we have the necessary apparatus of the media world to create a world of media persons, to create the infrastructure to support democracy, to support the fourth estate? We have a very distinguished panel here, and maybe start with Professor Stephen Quinn, Principal Mojo Media Insights. What do you think? What do you think about the panel discussion, sir?
I feel like a for 32 years, and I don't understand India. So how can I talk education in this country? So I'll talk about the result of the cricket last night.
is solved. Second point, that what is your combination between the different areas and imparting it through labs. In the morning session, it was said that the example was given of that film where it was said, entertainment, entertainment, entertainment. I would say, no, not that. You can have, give the emphasis on reading, writing, and practice. These three elements have to be kept in mind. While we are imparting education in India, we do not have any organization which can train the faculty members in imparting the education. I am surprised in this country when a teacher is appointed in intermediate class in high school, he should have, along with the master's degree, a B.Ed. degree also. But when he or she comes to the university, he can have the same master's degree without B.Ed. Well, what does it mean? It means that our teacher who comes as a faculty member, he has no training whatsoever how to impart teaching program to the students. This is my second point. There should be a National Council of Education, Media Education, Research and Training, which is very important. If this council is given this responsibility, maybe it can be located at Indian Institute of Mass Communication, or it can be located in any university. But the point is that there should be a certified National Council of Media Education, Research and Training, where we can organize time to time the courses related to media training for our faculty members. Third point I wanted to mention it, we should have media labs. We find in many institutions, media labs are missing. Print media labs should be there, where you should have all the softwares to bring out a daily newspaper or weekly newspaper. You should have a broadcasting lab. At least you should have equipments. In case of television, you should have all those editing equipments along with camera and all that. What I am trying to emphasize is, if you do not have the labs, then how are you going to train him? So therefore, this council will also be given the responsibility to find out whether these organizations have all these facilities or not. I think if these three small points which I have raised are taken care of, there will be a lot of improvement in the present status of media education in this country. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Devesh Kishore. Now, it's said that like actors, actors cannot be created, they are born actors. Similarly, journalists cannot be created in classrooms, you know, they are born journalists. So, Professor Biswajit Das, you not come here. From distinguished
not
Jamia,
here. No, not here.
Is not here. So, can we go on to Professor Sardana, please?
Yes. Yeah.
Professor Sardana, what are your thoughts? Can we create journalists in the classroom?
Good evening, everybody. Even though I did my PG diploma in journalism from Punjab University in 1955, but the basics of public relations I have learned the hard way. I spent 31 years in BHEL, starting from PRO and ending up as general manager, and then took to teaching. I spent another 18 years in teaching. My impression is that the teachers in media schools, they need to be given orientation in the exact working of that particular media. How can, what kind of situation is this, that a person who is a gold medalist in MA, APR or journalism or something, he does MPhil, he does PhD, and he becomes assistant professor and becomes a professor. And he has not entered into a newspaper office even one day. I also know that he has not entered a corporate public relations department even in one day. So what is important is that these teachers, they should be seconded to the media houses they should go and see there, what kind of work is there, number one. And second is that the senior persons who have spent lifetime in the practice of media, they should be actively associated with the media schools so that they can bring all the experiences which they have learned. I have seen right from the state level, local level, state level, national level, international level, how public relations is done, and there is no shortcut, there is no injection or capsule that you just take, and there is no question of whining and dining. It is a very serious matter, and it has to be dealt with very carefully and intelligently. Then only PR can be taught. And third point which I would like to make is that the students, somebody asked a question, how can we make the students fearless? We cannot make the students fearless. Yeah. It is just, it is inborn, it is inherent in the person. What kind of, and then, but, he, and last point which I would like to make, that the history of media teachers or media persons, they should be made compulsory to be read by the students, those so that they know how a person, what kind of challenges he faced, and how did he rise from A to B and C, and ultimately on the top. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. One important point he raised was that the classroom does not serve much purpose. In fact, we learn the hard way when we are on the job, you know. So it's the on-the-job training when we learn on the job in the newsroom that the real learning starts. So next question that I want to pose to Professor Ujjwal Chaudhary is, has the classroom become redundant? The entire process of communication that we imbibe in the newsroom, in the journalism lessons that we imbibe in newsrooms, or say in the PR consultancy. So what is the role that the classroom fulfills here?
I would not say that the classroom is redundant. I would rather say that the classroom can be made much more impactful if certain changes are done. And I would not restrict to journalism. I would rather look at the entire domain of media and communication. So from platforms like print and TV, the focus now has to also include mobile journalism and convergent journalism, where the same story is actually expressed in various manner in different volumes and sizes across various media. So 256 characters for Twitter, 2 to 3 paragraphs for online, 7 to 8 paragraphs or maybe around 500 words for newspaper, a more detailed story for a magazine, a podcast for radio or online. So therefore, there has to be the same story ability given to our youngsters to transform the same story into various formats and sizes. Cinema. Earlier it was cinema focus in the classrooms as well. We moved on to television focus. What we now need to make the classrooms also aware and alert to web entertainment, because it's the web entertainment that's calling the shots in the times to come. Earlier in Brandcom, the focus was only on advertising. We moved on to PR and events, as has been already mentioned. But what's now needed is an integrated brand communication or a digital brand communication. Now, this part of the awareness is still very low in the classroom. We had a lot of discussion on academic research. We moved on to communication research. What we perhaps now need to bring research centricity in the practice of communication, we need to bring in contextual or applied research. Due to lack of time, I'm not giving examples and detailing. Verbose expression, our expressions were very verbose. A lot of words were used. What we need to move is visual expression and data-based expression. So infographics, use of infographics, use of visuals, audio and video both, to tell the same story which we used so many words to tell earlier. We need to also move, we have traditionally taught that journalism as reporting is about 5 W's and 1 H, and views are about opinions, you know, opinionated articles. We need to move to a new formula of storytelling, a storytelling through multiple means. Again, I'm not getting into details of it. We had our education, which is very degree-centric. In fact, the only purpose that many of the universities serve is only dishing out degrees. We need to move to job, and then we brought in job centricity with the talk of placements in the private sector. What we perhaps now need is to move to career centricity, skill centricity, beyond jobs and degrees. There has also been the functions of communication, which were information, entertainment, education. Perhaps we need to now move to new areas of engagement and interaction. So it's not how many people you reach, the power of the media is understood by that. Rather, how many people you engage
even if you reach a smaller number. So engagement is the key word. Earlier, our focus was to learn more of media vehicles, print, TV, radio. Now the focus is shifting to communication and conversation rather. So it doesn't matter if a particular brand in the communication in the ecosystem is criticized in a social media. What's important is that people are engaging with the brand, good or bad, for both sorts of conversation. Earlier, almost no media management content was there. Limited media management was brought in, still now in most places. What's now needed, and I would like to humbly put, almost entire media education of India does not have media sales as a paper, does not have OTT as a content of media education, is not sensitive to the new requirements of audience measurements. People do talk about TRPs and all, but there is bark now, hardly it's a part of any education there. So audience measurements, media sales, media management, understanding of OTT and web entertainment, these are the new areas. We believed in recorded shooting. We did armchair or within studio recorded shooting. We moved on to practicing live shooting. But what now is required to go beyond and bring about augmented and virtual reality shooting, AR, VR shooting. Again, not getting into details. We always had a concept centricity. We were focusing on ideas and concepts. We moved to contexts. Perhaps now what's required as well is a design thinking in the context of media. Design thinking which brings concept, context, and packaging of the content together. And the last point, we always believed that media is about agenda setting, and the classrooms taught that. I would suggest, and then we said mirroring the society. But today what's required is to understand media to open the gates, not close it as agenda setters, and bring about a lot of user-generated content into the media. Whole concept of new media and mainstream media, this division has to actually be broken, and there has to be a seamless, continuous media between so-called mainstream and so-called new media. Without detailing, I just wanted to put these points in front. Thank you,
Professor. Thank you very much. Now, a journalist without credibility is no journalist at all. So what is the role that the classroom can play in instilling values like credibility in a journalist? So I would request Professor Sajal Mukherjee, Director APJ, to hold forth on this, please.
Since morning we were attending all the panels, we heard all the panels, and most of the points were covered there, but to crisp and give you the answer, the credibility of an institute, college or centers is dependent on the kind of curriculum that they are conducting, how balanced they are, industry interaction, that how they are inviting or encouraging the industry professional to come and take classes and interact with the students, the kind of infrastructure and facilities that they are providing, and the kind of placement they are giving, their legacy. Now these are the basic points where credibility of an institute is being judged. And there are also institutes which are creating their credibility or through their marketing or PR effect. So basically you have two streams. One is the credible institution, and there are a lot of visible institutions. Now in this, the most preferred institute where people like to go and take, or the industry people take their students for their jobs and all they offer, is the institute which are more credible and visible. They are an institute which are low on credibility but high on visibility, but they are just attracting the students. And they are an institute which are low on visibility and high on credibility. Their focus is basically to create and churn out students which are industry ready. There are students which can go into the academics and the research and pursue their knowledge pursuit. So this is how broadly you can look at the institute and judge the institute in terms of their credibility parameter.
Thank you, Professor Sajal Mukherjee. Now, May I request Professor Sunil Kant Behra, Head Tejpur University.
I will go there. I'm basically a teacher, you know.
So I request you to wind up the discussion and also pass the concluding remarks.
I will. Yes. I might be a little caustic. I was not here the whole day. Very good evening to all of you. I know we are in a very informal setting. That makes me feel that I am in Delhi. And we are talking about a very serious subject. The panel was for status of media education. I have been teaching communication for the last 38 years. I do not call myself a media educator. I am teaching communication, of which media is a part, a component, maybe a very important component, but I teach communication. We are here in Delhi. We talk in unison about the requirements of education today. We do not talk about the commitment. We do not talk about the difficulties. We do not talk about the challenges. We simply talk about a sugar-coated view that it should be like this. I will not agree to it. I will stay for 5-7 minutes. I'm sure you will not listen, but that's my job as a teacher. Education, communication, education, there is growth. In India, when we started in the 60s, maybe there were 20 institutions educating on communication. But today we have about 1,000 institutions of varied nature, varied nomenclature, offering these courses. But there is a lot of diversities and widespread disparities in education today. If we think about the geographic disparity, a university in Delhi cannot be equal with an institute in Odisha. We have metro centers of education. Capital cities have universities and colleges and institutes, and in rural areas also we have communication departments, and there is a lot of disparity. What we teach here in Delhi will not be acceptable to the students of Northeast or to the students of Odisha. They come from different backgrounds. Talking about the institutions again, we have government universities, central universities, state universities, private universities, media-run journalism schools. They have different agendas. They have different problems. We cannot standardize. In one session, I was listening to standardization of communication education. That itself is not possible and also not feasible. Maybe we can have some commonalities in the curriculum, but those need to be contextualized in different institutions and in different settings. Talking about the nomenclature again, we are giving them diplomas, we are giving them short-term skill-based courses. We are teaching them at graduate level. We are teaching them at postgraduate, MPhil and PhD level. But unfortunately, in the UGC, communication is still today a vocational subject. We do not have that kind of recognition as other disciplines have. Still, it is being offered as a vocational subject. And of course, we have grown. Quantitatively, we have grown, but qualitatively, it is much less than desired. There is a change of, if we look at the journey of, we are talking much about media growth. Media has changed. Education has also changed. Earlier, we were teaching journalism. Today, we are teaching communication as a discipline. We are teaching not only the skills, but we are teaching the sociology of communication, the ecology of communication, the economics of communication. We are teaching them all. Because we are not simply training them to be employed in the media organizations. We also have a duty to train them to become teachers, train them to become policy makers. That is our purpose. Our purpose is not simply to be job driven. And again, there is a difference. Earlier we were teaching journalism, we are now teaching communication. We were teaching earlier writing skills. Today, Professor Chowdhury talked about we have to teach them not only writing skills, but we have to teach them visual skills. We have to teach them audiovisual skills. We have to teach them the digital skills. And moreover, we have to teach them the technological skills, because media have become technology driven today. And honestly speaking, this teaching them the technological skills has somehow is overshadowed the creative skills of this discipline. Students are more into, I will take 2 more minutes. Earlier, education, media education was content driven. Now it is technology driven. Earlier we were teaching what is news. Today we are teaching them what is fake news, what is paid news. Earlier we were teaching them information scarcity. Today we are teaching them information overload. Earlier we were teaching them only functions of communication, and today we are teaching them dysfunctions of communication. We were teaching them the information order. Today we are teaching them what is information disorder. What is misinformation, what is disinformation, what is malinformation. So we have moved a lot of, if we were teaching them print and analog, we are now teaching them digital and mozo. So growth is there qualitatively and quantitatively, but certainly there is a lack of commitment, I will say, from ourselves. Over these 45 or 50 years, we have failed. We have been debating on how to make media education more relevant, but we have been debating even today. Much depends on the younger faculties. I am very proud to say that today we have a band of younger faculty members who are keen to take this education forward. But again, the UGC has made it, they are running after this API course. I don't blame them for that, but that is the reality. So think about these things, and I have tried to show you the mirror, not with sugar-coated words, but that is the reality. Go to a department in a rural area and you will find the low intake quality. Not all the students are like the Delhi students. So when you think about education, think about the pan-India perspective and think about the solution. Thank you very much.
Very relevant points. Thank you so much, Professor. Please have your seat. So that brings to an end this enlightening session of discussions on the state of media education in India. Over to you, Karthik.
Thank you so much, gentlemen. I'd like to call upon Mr. Sagar Kaushik, co-founder Please and Strides Foundation, to kindly come on stage and felicitate all of our speakers. Mr. Kaushik.
Just a minute though, we've got to felicitate all of you. Yeah.
Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you, Suman. I'd request Professor Stephen Quinn to stay on and deliver the guest of honor speech to round off the day.
Sorry, friends. This is my duty, I believe, to thank Extend for Media and Business World, and particularly Professor Surbhi Dahiya, for taking up this and also publishing the directory, which perhaps no other teacher in the country has succeeded in doing this. A big round of applause for Surbhi Dahiyaji for her wonderful work of publishing the directory. Thank you very much.